As the earth slowly tilts away from the sun, winter shadows begin to stretch out across the North Country. Each day, less sunlight and less solar energy reach the land. Moisture falling through the cold air freezes into a crystalline comforter, covering the earth, tucking it in for a long winter's nap. Most forms of life respond to this role of the planet by slowing down, conserving what little energy remains. Sap slips down into the roots of trees, beginning the long wait until spring's uprisings. Life seems to be silently settling into winter. But there is a creature whose season just begins with the first snowfall, whose life brightens into the low winter sun. This is the Alaskan sled dog, a husky who has anticipated the changing season since the first frosty nights of August. These sled dogs are not house pets. They are working animals and they work hard for their living. And they love their work. Sled dogs are creatures of the snow and the cold and the moonlight. Hours ago, two other creatures arose to share that snow and that cold and that moonlight. Like my dogs, I too love winter best. Most mushers do. Why else would we choose to live on the 64th parallel, where winter rules from October through April? I love starting out my day by going out and making the rounds of the dog yard.
Wake up, guys! Here comes.
My dogs take good care of me, and I try to take good care of them. I give them plenty of food, water, and TLC, and for me that works. Every musher has a different way of relating to his or her dogs. These dogs are some of my best friends. We spend many hours a day on the trail together. For me, it makes sense to share that time with good friends.
Here comes your breakfast.
Take my friend here, Little Joe. He's one of my favorites. But then again, I have 13 favorites, each for a different reason. Little Joe is a mixed breed husky, bred more for his working qualities than for show. Most sled dogs are not purebred dogs, but a conglomeration of bloodlines constantly evolving to fill the demands of the mushers who breed them. Little Joe is a large freighting dog. He weighs about 90 pounds. He has just the build I'm looking for in sled dogs, long legs and a rangy body. In deep snow, Joe's the dog to have breaking trail. Joe's feet are compact. The toes fit neatly together with stiff, bristly hair between them. Little Joe has a dense double coat with stiff guard hairs and a soft downy undercoat. This combination protects him even at 60 below zero. But Little Joe's most impressive quality is his spirit, his intense desire to work hard pulling a sled. Big Joe, Little Joe's father, had that same desire. He'd work his heart out for you. Good attitude is the most important trait to select for in breeding sled dogs. Here's Nellie, the mother dog of my kennels. Nellie is a lead dog when she's not doing time in the pen. The puppy pen, that is. Last fall, she had two little pups, and what that litter lacked in number, the two pups made up for in size. They stayed warm near Nellie, and I loved to watch them snuggle up, grunting their little contented moans. With milk enough to feed 8 pups, these 2 were little porkers, little blimps. In just a few weeks, they had tripled in size and were a little more adventuresome. One sad morning, I found the male pup dead in his home. He seemed so healthy, I can't imagine what killed him. I sure missed him, and so did his sister, which I named Solo, because now she was all alone. At 3 months, Solo was eager to follow her mom down new trails. Did she have an inkling of what her life as a sled dog would hold? By 4 months, she was fast enough to follow the team, but Solo had visions of being a lead dog. A 100 yards down the trail, she was back where she belonged. Puppies tire out quickly, so I loaded her in the sled and gave her a ride.
And we'll just snap you on there so you can't fall out. Pump out. Stay in.
Next, I put a harness on Solo and let her get the feel of pulling something. Her friends back at the dog yard cheer her on. At 6 months, I put her in the team next to Nellie. I think Solo liked being up in front of the sled with the big dogs. Later in the spring, I put her up in the head of the team. Maybe she will turn out to be a lead dog. This curious canine is my biggest dog and the funniest. Sometimes I get the feeling he thinks he's in the team of Sergeant Preston of the Yukon, and I don't have the heart to tell him otherwise. As a matter of fact, Jack reminds me of some of the old-time dogs bred back at the turn of the century. These dogs were heftier than the Siberian breeds used by the Eskimos. Many mushers today prefer smaller dogs, 40, 50 pounds, but I like the big dogs like Jack. Explorers and traders opened up the north with their dog teams. The Hudson Bay Company brought the world's demand for fur to the north, and native trappers enlarged their trap lines with the help of their dog teams. Trappers also brought their furs to the trading posts with these teams. The Royal Northwest Mounted Police depended on dogs to run their patrols to keep justice in the north, as every Sergeant Preston fan well knows. During the gold rush, all winter supplies were hauled by dogs. Food, clothing, building supplies, gold, mail, and even passengers. Everything relied on the dog team until spring breakup allowed boats to ply the rivers. Judges and clergymen traveled the north by dogs, bringing law and order and religion to the people. And where there's two dog teams, of course, there's going to be a race. And today, dog teams are still opening up new worlds for people. Our dogs have allowed us to live out some of our dreams. We wanted to build a cabin in the woods and learn what that life had to teach. For two people from the suburbs of Milwaukee, this was quite a change, quite a challenge, quite an adventure. The dogs made it possible to live here in this peaceful forest about 30 miles from Fairbanks. They skidded in the heavy green spruce logs that John would craft into the walls of a house. As the rounds of logs grew higher, our hearts knew that this was the right place. We worked long days as the forest shook off the mantle of winter and relaxed into spring. The next summer, we returned with some friends and put on the sod roof. Again, the dogs helped transport the 100-pound clumps of moss and earth. In early winter, when the first snow softened the trail, the dogs freighted in the finishing touches for the cabin. The windows, the 500-pound cook stove, the treadle sewing machine, and the old earthenware crocks my grandmother used to use back on the farm in Wisconsin. And to this day, the dogs still pull in supplies to fill those crocks, the cache, the root cellar, and the dog food barrels. The dogs pull in 50 gallons of water in a single trip from the creek. And that's the coldest, freshest water in the world. It flows out of the ground about 30 feet above the waterhole, so we don't have to worry about pollution or parasites. Now that's what I call running water. And there's always firewood to bring into the woodshed. We fill it up each spring so the wood is under cover over the summer. Green birch takes 2 years to dry out after it's split. And we use the dry, dead spruce for the cook stove. There's a warm, secure feeling in knowing the cabin will be snug and cozy no matter how low the temperature dips. Working with the dogs in our chores is an integral part of living here. They are eager helpers and they have a natural desire to please. They love their work. But every once in a while I have a little trouble with that black dog right there behind the leader. That's Misty. It's not that Misty is really lazy. I guess she just remembers another life. You see, I gave Misty away as a pet when she was 6 weeks old. A year later, her owners were leaving town, and they gave Misty back to me. I harnessed her up with the team and she fit in well. But she's sort of a tourist sometimes. She's just going along to see new country. But she comes through in a pinch. She even pulled the team across the finish line one year in the 1,000-mile Yukon Quest sled dog race. So Misty's earned a place in my heart, as well as my team. To build a home with our hands and the resources of the woods around us, to fetch our own water, gather our own firewood, search for the bright berries in late summer, and a fat, careless moose in the fall, this life has lessons to teach. The dogs do a lot of work for us, but in our turn, we do a lot of work for the dogs. The team is a 365-day-a-year responsibility, and they deserve the best care we can give them. Just like the rest of us, the dogs need food, water, shelter, exercise, and attention. Buying the dog food is a major expense, running about $1 a day a dog. We buy dog food by the ton, some years using commercially prepared feed, and other years cooking ground barley to mix with fish meal and fat.
It's a real pleasure for me to get to share dog sledding with you. I've lived in Alaska for 20 years.
Just like everyone else, we Alaskans have to work for our living. My team and I work with the riverboat Discovery in the summer, sharing dog sledding with visitors to Fairbanks. I really enjoy meeting people from all around the world. The dogs love the attention and the activity.
You might be a musher when you grow up. I have a whole team of these guys.
Yeah. In this way, we earn our living for the rest of the year. Now, my favorite dog chore is distributing fresh hay to all the dog houses. The dogs love the sweet dry grass and they can hardly wait to get in to investigate the new additions to their nests. The sweet aroma must be intoxicating to creatures with such a keen sense of smell. And of course, there's another important daily chore, cleaning up the dog yard. This is not so bad when I take time to play with each dog as I make my rounds. Oh, I almost forgot the most important responsibility of owning a dog team.
Okay, you guys, you want to go? Schnitzel? You want to go for a run? Who wants to go for a run with me?
We must run the dogs every day. First of all, you need a responsive, intelligent, dependable, level-headed lead dog. That's Schnitzel. He's my number one leader. He seems to enjoy the responsibility of being the leader. Some dogs don't. I give each dog the opportunity to try running up in front of the team. The two dogs directly behind the leaders are called swing dogs. They help swing the team around corners. This is also a good place to train future lead dogs. The rest of the dogs are called team dogs, with the exception of the two dogs directly in front of the sled. These are wheel dogs and they really work hard to pull the sled around tight corners. After the team is all harnessed up, I don't linger. I pull the slipknot and we're off. The first few miles are the most exciting. The dogs are eager to kick up their heels and I hang on for dear life. Sometimes I let a few dogs run loose behind the sled because the first stretch is just too steep and narrow to go out with that much power.
Come
Once we're across the icy creek, everyone's part of the team again.
Ready, Pooka? Okay.
The lead dog sets the pace for the rest of the team, so it's best to have one of your fastest dogs in this position. Schnitzel is 7 years old now, and he has to work a little harder to stay out in front of the younger dogs. There are no reins attached to the team, just a few vocal commands to tell the lead dog what you want him to do. To turn right, I say,
Jeep, Jeep.
When I want to go back in the same direction I just came from, I give the command,
Come haw. Come haw, Schnitzel. Come haw.
This is handy if you drop a mitten or miss a turn on the trail.
Straight ahead. Straight ahead. Straight ahead. Straight ahead.
To stop the team, the command is,
Whoa!
I won't tell you what I holler when they don't stop.
Easy.
Hear that little... That gets the dogs going, but it almost got me in big trouble once. I had 12 dogs harnessed up to go. John kissed me goodbye, and the dogs mistook the of the kiss for the to go. I just barely grabbed the sled as they zoom by. Haw is the command to turn to the left, and my dogs, they'll turn on a dime.
Haw! Haw! Schnitzel! Haw! Haw!
Attaboy! Haw!
Well, that time the dime must have been covered with snow. Okay, boys, now that the work is over, it's time for some real fun. You see, this is the dog's social hour. When they're playing together, they work on their pecking order. Then I don't have trouble with them fighting when they're in the team.
There they go!
And it's Sue Tan going to the front. Cabbage is second on the rail. Beautiful Linda is third by a length. And into the back spits. Dog Biscuit is now leading the pack. Lady Evelyn is second, very close. Banana is coming up through the bunch at the half. Sue Tan still out in front. Apartment House is second with plenty of room. Assault is passing battery. Assault battery! Notary Soul Jack is fourth. And in last place by 10 lengths, I believe it is. Yes, it is Fetal Bomb.
Sometimes after their romp, I let the dogs into the cabin. I can take off my winter coat, but the dogs can't take off theirs. Soon it sounds like the Alaska Railroad just pulled in.
Decision.
hot in here for you. Want to go outside?
Huh?
Want to go out? Want to go out? Oh, let's go.
Once everyone's chained up again, I catch up on my chores and get dinner started. The small root cellar under the cabin is our refrigerator. It holds a steady temperature of about 36 degrees, just right to keep fruits and vegetables. The moose meat and salmon keep frozen up in the high cache. We cut and wrapped it last fall, so it's easy to find just what we want for dinner. Maybe John will choose salmon for tonight. Dog sleds really take a beating, and they're in constant need of repair. I'm fortunate to be married to someone who can put them back together again. John earns his living as a custom woodworker, and he's a real artist with wood. While dinner is cooking, I usually snatch a few moments to work on my writing. Sounds like John's doing a little woodworking of a different order. The rounds of spruce split easily in the cold weather. The dogs are eager for their meal, yet some of them are dainty eaters. However, Beetle Bomb is a dog of a different color. As a pup, Beetle was the slowest of the litter. When the young dogs were chasing the team, I'd always have to wait for Beetle Bomb to catch up. As he finally came padding down the trail, relaxed at his own ambling speed, I'd find myself singing the old Spike Jonze song.
Is fourth, and in last place by 10 lengths, I believe it is, yes, it is Beetlebum.
Puppy names have a way of sticking with dogs, and Beetlebum is still Beetlebum. But when it comes to eating, Beetlebum is the fastest dog on my team. It's well past sunset when John and I finally sit down to enjoy a peaceful dinner. It's been another rewarding day, as are most of them, out here in the old forest. It's the last Saturday in February. 47 teams from Canada, Alaska, and the lower 48 states are waiting for the countdown to begin the 1,000-mile Yukon Quest International Sled Dog Race, a cross-country odyssey stretching from Fairbanks, Alaska, to Whitehorse, Yukon Territory, Canada. It is said a journey of 1,000 miles must begin with a single step. Well, I took that step as I finished my last Yukon Quest, when I decided to race again. And preparing for a race like this is a year-long proposition. The blue sky and green leaves of summer are only a distant memory now, but I'm grateful I can earn my living and money for race expenses working with the dogs all summer long. It's tough sledding on the gravel, but better than no sledding at all. As the summer fades to early autumn, about mid-August, the nightly temperatures fall with the setting sun. The dogs sense a change coming and they seem energized by the cool air. It must be autumn because Uproar goes crazy when he's let loose. He zooms around the dog yard. Perhaps he's looking for a snowy trail.
Good dog. Come here.
With the first snowfall, we hit the trail, but to avoid hitting it literally, I run with a small team, just 3 or 4 dogs. As the snow deepens, the trails soften and the team expands by a dog or 2 or 4. And the distance we run also increases, 8, 15, 20, 40 miles a day. We'll log some 1,500 miles before the race in February. Some dogs have the enthusiasm to run 1,000 miles, but there's more to racing than just running. Flopsy's a young dog who needs to learn several important lessons before she's ready to race. First of all, she must learn to drink before her water freezes solid. To encourage her, I add dog food to her water, but it doesn't always work. Second, she must learn to rest in harness and not chew on the lines. Finally, Flopsy must learn to wear booties. Dogs don't like things strapped on their feet, so it's important to make this introduction before the race. Booties are used to protect the dog's tender pads from rough trail conditions, and with proper care, sore feet can actually heal on the trail. During a long-distance race, a dog musher will use anywhere from 600 to 1,000 booties. To pay for things like booties, most mushers seek sponsors to help support their race effort. In December, sunlight is a precious commodity in interior Alaska. On December 21st, the winter solstice, we get about 4 hours of daylight. Hardly enough time to do all that needs to be done before the big race. By late January, panic sets in. Sometimes I wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning, scheming about some aspect of the race. There's nothing else to do but get up and go to work on the new idea, at least on paper. I hope I have enough dog food sent out. I don't want those guys to get hungry out there. 160 pounds to Dawson. No, I'm going to need more for that long stretch. It's 290 miles. But then a new idea starts working on me. Why am I doing this? Well, it's like this. Some people escape to a tropical island. My idea of paradise is the dog trail. I like the adventure of a 1,000-mile wilderness trek. Oh, sure, I'm too tired and too cold to really experience the country with all my senses, but there's a basic contentment in being there. The misery, it's expected. All the rest that comes along, that's a surprise. And the biggest surprise is suddenly waking up and it's the morning of the race. It's time to load the dogs in their truck and head downtown to Fairbanks. The dogs jump into the truck as they've done before, not knowing they'll run 1,000 miles before they see that truck again. As we wait for our starting number to be called, the veterans on the team seem to remember the excitement. But the young dogs, the rookies, they're all wide-eyed and excited. Me too.
Yeah, Mary's smiling already. She's having a good time down there. Dogs are all raring to go. Some of hers look pretty calm. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go, Mary. Mary is off in the 1988 class.
Once we're out of town, we're feeling a lot more comfortable. The dogs look good. I'm beginning to relax. No more lists, no more errands. We either have it with us or we don't.
Come on, Schnitzel. Take it easy, Flopsy. We got a long way to go. Easy does it, Flopsy.
Old Schnitzel seems to remember every mile of the trail. He's setting a reasonable pace. He knows. After a day or two, the teams spread out. The serious competitors make their move, and the race is on. Out there on the long trail. Let me tell you. First of all, it's quiet. Just the sounds of the sled runners sliding along, the dogs panting, and the neckline snaps jingling. I may go miles without saying a word to the dogs, or I may sing them a little song to let them know I'm still in good spirits. I got a dog and his name is Joe. I got a dog and his name is Jay. One year, while traveling up the Yukon River toward Eagle, I thought I heard little bits of conversation blowing in the wind. I heard mushers giving commands to their teams, but when I turned around, expecting to see a team overtaking me, the trail was empty. Were these commands left over from the gold rush, words still lingering in the air nearly a century after being spoken, words doomed to whirl around in the wind forever? When you have an experience like that, it's good to have your best friends along. Cold is a constant companion, 20 below, 30, 50, even 60 below zero. By halfway through the race, lack of sleep catches up with me. The cold seems colder, the chores more difficult. We've fallen into a routine. We may run for 4 hours and then rest for two. Run for 6 hours, rest for four. We run by day, we run by night. Camp is nothing more than a wide spot in the trail. What I'd give for 6 hours of sleep. Another team passes us by. I want to keep going, but I know my team needs rest and food. We've been up since midnight, or was it noon? Day and night run together now. A simple chore like feeding the dogs takes all my concentration. My friends enjoyed their meal, but even more, I think they'd enjoy curling up in the hay back home. Now that everyone's comfortable, I'll just curl up on my sled bag and get a half an hour of sleep. Surely a half an hour couldn't hurt. Now the whole race seems like a dream, and reaching the finish line is a dream come true. I don't know why I always seem to finish in the middle of the night, long after the crowds and cameras have gone home. It's a personal challenge I'm racing for, and I know when I've met that challenge.
Okay. Oh, congratulations.
Thank you.
Welcome home.
It's good to be here. It took a long time to get here.
Yeah, well, not quite as long as walking, huh?
Yeah, a little bit faster.
Let's have a look at your sled here.
Okay, snowshoes, axe, sled.
I can take it. You want to take a look at your dog?
Yeah, I'd like to go up and see my dog.
Okay.
Hi, guys. Hi, dog. Good dog, huh? Good dog.
It's victory for me if I've done the best I can, if I've taken good care of the dogs and been a good companion to my fellow mushers.
Okay, Mary, looks like you checked out just fine. You want to sign this?
You betcha. Last time I got to fill out one of these forms.
That's right.
Won't be able to read it, but I'll sign it.
You got
a match
set now.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Thank you for all your help.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
The dogs hear John drive up, and they're eager to clamber into their pickup truck.
Oh, good job. A few days we'll be home again, and after a little R&R, everything's the same. Well, not the same. You're never quite the same after a journey of 1,000 miles. But the season of the sled dog is not over yet. In fact, our favorite season is just now in full swing. March 21st, the spring equinox finds the land and all its creatures celebrating the return of Old Soul. An invigorating energy shimmers in the forest as the sky brightens about 6 a.m. A teasing wind swirls by all day, singing of faraway places. On this wind blows the wanderlust, the urge to explore new country.
Spring is the time to travel the frozen paths across Alaska's wilderness, now while hundreds of miles, thousands of miles of trail lace the land.
Don't forget the snowshoes.
Okay.
Is this gonna fit or is this gonna fit? I want my parka right on top in case it turns chilly up on the ridge. Get it out.
John and I are not the only ones eager to be off on a spring trip. The temperature is comfortable, and in the afternoon it's downright hot. All we can do is smile back at the yellow warmth surrounding us and peel off another layer of clothes. Sometimes you're buzzing along and poof, the trail disappears, dead end. Nothing else to do but pull out the snowshoes and break your own trail. The dogs must enjoy this role reversal. Unlike the race, there's no pressure to constantly press on. Instead, we take our time to relax and relish the balmy weather, the clean country, and the good company. In the north, it's best to heed Mother Nature's warnings. High clouds in the morning can mean deep snow by evening. We'll make camp a little early tonight, down in the shelter of the old forest. Each night's camp seems more perfect than the last. Chores take about an hour, and in that short time, we create a cozy, comfortable home.
Here are the sleeping bags.
Oh.
I'll go get the dog fire going.
Okay.
After several days on the trail, a simple dinner tastes like a banquet. A sleeping bag is as comfortable as any feather bed. and the tent is so warm, we get drowsy even before the sun sets. Each new day is a precious gift, a fresh start. Exploring new country by dog team renews the spirit. Unfamiliar regions on a map slowly become a part of our experience. As we travel through an area, we gain a deeper understanding of this vast land. The dogs seem to share our delight in discovering new trails, especially where new smells are concerned. However, as these bare patches enlarge, we realize that spring is beginning to surrender to summer, and it's time to head home. Before we reach the river, John and I will part company, he to Fairbanks to complete a woodworking job, and I'll take the scenic route the long way home, if the river ice allows me passage, that is. It's been an especially warm spring this year, and breakup may come early. For centuries, Alaska's frozen rivers have been her winter highways. Focus shifts to far horizons, freeing the mind to follow. Out on the river, musher and team can drink in all the wide, wild beauty that is Alaska. However, that wide open route is not without its hazards. We pick our way carefully over some overflow ice. I give the dogs calm, confident commands. Sometimes the musher's view from 6 feet up can find the safest route. Other times, the lead dog's intuition is a more reliable judge of the weakening ice. Gets, the more valuable become Schnitzel's years of trail experience and his keen sense of smell. It's a relief to be back on solid ground, although I'd like to see more snow on top of that ground. The dogs pick up the pace, knowing that this trail leads us home. With spring travels behind them, it's time for my friends to rest. But they have lots of snowy memories to dream about, and only 5 months to wait until the next season of the Sled Dog.
Last place by 10 lengths, I believe it is. Yes, it is.
Three, oh.